Thank you for your worship today, and thank you for your Holy Spirit being in this room, in and around and through us, that you are creating courage and joy and so much wisdom and understanding during your worship without any words exchanged, just the power of praise. I thank you, Lord, that you have matured our church congregation and you're not finished yet, Lord, that you're just constantly molding us and shaping us to look like you in every single area of our lives and to act like you, more importantly, in every single area of our lives. Lord, please put your mighty hand on everybody's income that has tied to you, Lord, and give them abundance. Like your word says, you will throw open the floodgates when we activate faith in our tithes and offerings. Thank you, Lord, for that access to you. And thank you most of all that you're teaching us in this church to show how to apply your word in each and every moment of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I don't know if y'all want to get a little tablet. We have some extra tablets, so I have index cards, but today we're not doing a full chapter. We're kind of going around. And I'm going to wait for y'all to get to every verse. I just wanted to let you know because I think that the study, if you continue to study around these verses all week, you will get a real intimacy with the Lord and really grow. If you end your time with the Lord. To do that. So if you need any of that, Chelsea will help you all too. And if you need a Bible, she'll get that for you too. But they have some tablets at the bottom and index cards on that table. And the first first verse we're going to go to today is Isaiah 64:8 in the New King James Version. Y'all know how in this cold weather we all like the gumbo. We start cooking gumbos and soups and all that, right? So God's just telling us, it's fall, y'all. It's fall, y'all. It's time to get that gumbo pot out. So that's what this is. It's a little bit of everything to help us to grow and be molded. Isaiah 64:8 in the New King James Version. Isaiah 64:8. And I taught a little bit about this, so some of it will sound familiar in another message, but it was something that kept on. I think it was like the 30th message, so it was like the first year when we kind of first started. And so a few of the pieces are in there. Yeah, that was really important, huh?
Mine's in the line.
It is, yeah. It's about, and y'all just let me know when y'all all ready. And that's Isaiah 64:8, the New King James Version for anyone online. Just waiting on a bit. I'm just teasing you a bit.
Yes.
She's making fun of you.
Of course.
Now you said I'm lost.
We gotta laugh.
Oh, yeah. I'm making fun of you. I'm repeating you.
What did you say?
You said I was repeating you. I'm lost.
It's in the Old Testament.
You found?
It's in the Old Testament. Isaiah 64:8.
How did you find it?
Look with her a bit. Look. But now.
It's 10:76.
Huh?
I told you 10:76.
No. Oh, the page number, yeah.
Yeah, I usually give her the page number.
And she gave it to you this time? That's good. Not that means you're teaching her right, Mama. That's a good thing. So this, just to kind of give you a little inside story, this is talking about how God is our craftsman, our potter. He's the one that molds us and helps us to be strong and helps us to be created in his image. So that's what we're going to be learning about. It says, but now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay and you are the potter. And all we are the work of your hand. So he's teaching us that all of us is the work of his hands. It's just like he's sitting there molding us into shape. So do you think that don't hurt?
Yes.
It does. You ever see a pretty vase or a pretty coffee cup or a pretty teacup on the shelf when you go shopping, or those pretty plates? And you're like, wow, those are really, really pretty. But you don't never think of the process to get those real ones, those real expensive ones, you know, that cost a lot of money.
They,
they mold them like that movie. Y'all seen that movie? What Ghost, I think it is, mm-hmm. where they mold in the clay. Or they have other things they show like that. But the moral of the story is they mold it. They take chunks out of it. They throw it out of your life, right? And then they put it in the oven to bake it and heat it and shape it and paint it. And then you got to put it back in the oven again when you're all pretty, right? When you're all pretty and holy as a Christian. And you got to put it back in the oven to be baked again. So don't ever think because you're feeling all this heat and all this pressure and all this pulling apart and all this molding that you're not a Christian and that you're not growing in Christ. He's trying to shape and purify all the stuff that you would have had from birth if you would have known better from birth, right? But none of us get to know better from birth. I don't think any of us was that fortunate to know better and do it. Because some of us get to know better, but we don't get to do it, right? So you have to picture this. You're in that molding stage. You're always constantly growing to be purified for that. But you get it put in that extreme heat sometimes. And most of the time, sure, it's something we've sown in and it's time to reap it. That way, so if you remember something or recall something that you've done in the past or somebody's done to you, instead of letting it make your body cringe thinking about somebody that's cheated on you or hurt you or slapped you in the face, that's God letting it come to the surface. It's not the devil. It's letting God let it come to the surface so you can forgive that person or forgive yourself and ask for forgiveness so that it can be healed and you'll be broken from that generational curse. That's what this is about today, being broken from generational curses and being set free to have generational blessings and freedom in your family. Most people like to talk about, well, that's a generational curse. That's a generational curse. How about we focus on the generational freedom that we're going to give the next generation, because it's the same way, and we're going to learn that today. In Romans 12, 2, in the New King James Version, the New Testament, New King James Version. She's going to tease you the whole time, man.
We heard me calls.
She was blinded for you.
You were.
Well, I think it is.
So that's Romans 2. And it's 12:2. And it says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So try to break even that generational curse that says, God, the devil's after me again today. God, the devil did this today. God, help me get the devil. Stop giving him, stop calling him into your world, because he's not yours.
Amen.
He's not in your world anymore. And if we totally ignore him, what happens to the enemy that you totally ignore?
They go away.
They go away because they know you're not going to mess with them. And you know you're not going to entertain them. So don't even call them into existence that way. He said, let it be me. Let it be me that's bringing the bad memory to you so you can forgive and be forgiven. Let it be me that's tempting you. I mean, not tempting you. Let it be me that's testing you. God doesn't tempt anyone. Let it be me that's testing you and allowing, the better word is allowing. Like Lamentation says, there's not a thing on earth that God does not approve that happens. So we like to say, well, the devil did this to me, yes, but God approved it, like Jude. Remember Jude? He approved it because he said, my servant's not going to turn his back. My servant's not going to say I'm not with him. My servant, he said, go ahead, devil, mess with him. Because my servant, my child of God, my son or daughter knows better. And they're not going to do nothing. Go ahead. And it made him stronger and stronger. Yes, he went through the worst. He went through the worst of all of them, I believe. And he still stayed strong. And you know why God allowed that? He didn't allow that to hurt him. He allowed that so even today we would see it whenever we're going through something bad, that God is there the whole time. But the teacher is always quiet during the test, right? Right. He gives us all the information. He's more gracious than our teachers, though, right? He gives us the open book test. He says, all you got to do is go back and look. It's right there. Just go back and look. It's right there. So just always remember that. But also in your mind is the worst attack. I see a huge shift in the world where it's mostly the mind that's being attacked. And if you can hold fast and let God transform your mind by casting it out. Chloe even embarrassed me one day and said what I used to do because I didn't know the verses real good. Y'all ever been there where you didn't know the verses real good? And you was just becoming a Christian. And I would sit there and be like, no, 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 no. That's all I could get out my mouth. But I would say it because it made it go away. And if that's all you can say, say it. That's activating faith. Don't get to a point where you don't learn the verses, but use what you got to use till you do. And then you just grow and you mature because the mind's being attacked right now. Because it's hard to attack people these days with even their own children. You know why? Because somebody else always knows somebody else will take care of them. So even whenever they see their children hurt or without, they still don't care. And it happens to all of us. We can't blame anyone. We get caught up at work and we're like, oh, well, somebody else will take care of them. We get caught up on the streets. Somebody else will take care of them. We get caught up in the Lord. Amen. Somebody else will take care of them. You ever had a person that's in church 24/7, but don't never know what their husband or their wife or what their children need because they don't take time for them? It's not about that. It's about letting your body and mind be purified for him to do what he would do everywhere you're at. And when you do that, you can be having church anywhere you're at. Anywhere. Anywhere. No matter what. In 2 Corinthians 5:17. And why are you looking for that? It's in the news team. We have a lot of verses. That's why I'm saying that. Not because of you, yet. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, in the New King James Version, just think of that Play-Doh. You ever play with Play-Doh when you was little? It's kind of like the clay also, right? So do you want somebody just constantly sitting at a table and playing with you and using you and then tossing you back in the canister?
No.
That's what people will do.
Right.
No matter who they are. That's what they're going to do.
True.
But if you let God be your potter, and you're the clay, it's a whole different situation. You're going to become that beautiful vase or that beautiful plate or that beautiful cup, right? So you got to let him be the potter. You don't let other people play with that Play-Doh because you're not meant to be used, and you're not meant to be squeezed and pushed and pulled apart. You're meant to be that clay for the potter. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Y'all circle that part. Scratch a big old line under that part. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Do you have to do anything to have that? Just repent. That's it. He said, I'll take care of the rest. And as you learn my word, do my word. It's that simple. He rather you read a verse and try to figure out how to apply that verse in your life every day than to go to church 7 days a week. And I'm a pastor, and I'll tell you that. Because he's wondering if you're going to learn and receive his word and actually do it no matter where you're at. That's what he's focused on. He's saying, I'm going to turn you into a new creation of Christ, in Christ. Whenever you go around new family or new friends, hopefully you're changing enough to where that child or that adult or that old friend is like, wow, what happened to you? And they see that new creation in Christ that they can't believe. Sure, they're going to try to act like you to that same old person again. And sometimes you might try to act like that old person to fit in with them, right?
Right.
But if you hold strong and you don't do that, they'll get the chance to see the new creation in Christ, and they will see that beautiful face, and they will want to be like that too. That's more powerful than fitting in so they'll like you for that 5 minutes they're going to be in your life when you pass them by somewhere. Don't try to fit in with that. James 1, 2 through 4. And that's James 1, 2 through 4 in the New King James Version. While y'all looking for that, I seen a picture this week. Y'all probably seen it since I posted it. It was that good. It's like it's that simple, but that good. It was Jesus walking in the desert or something, and he had all kind of luggage, and he was like, why are you trying to pack your own luggage when he's wanting your own baggage whenever he's trying to pack yours for you? Why are you struggling with all that? And it just seemed like that was so simple but so powerful in that same thing. It's like he had all that baggage, and he was like, I'll hold it all for you, but you just got to give it to me. And sometimes we don't want to let go of that stuff. In James 1, 2 through 4, it says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. There's that word again, patience.
Patience.
Don't you dare give us stronger patience this week, Lord. We good. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Wouldn't that be something? Perfect and complete, lacking nothing. And it's a promise. It's a promise. I agree with that in Jesus' name, amen.
I agree on it.
Yes. But, like I always say, if we would have just read verse 4, we wouldn't know too much about verse 3. That's how you get it, right?
Right.
So the only way we could get to perfect and complete lack of nothing is by enduring the patience, which is hard. It's very hard. And when you pray for patience, let me tell you, every cuckoo out of the woodwork's coming your way. And they're going to test you and tempt you. But if you stand strong and you fight back, because think about it. Think about if you wouldn't do it one time. Try it one time and see the difference. And then it'll get addictive just like the other. I fall and fail in this so much because I get tired just like everybody else. I'm human flesh.
Amen.
And I'm getting closer when I say I rebuke that. Lord, forgive me right after. You know, you're getting closer. But I'm not going to stand here and say I don't get aggravated with people and places and things. But with each thing, I find I get less and less aggravated or I react to it less and less of a way. And I know that y'all are too. And if not, I know y'all will. In Jesus' name, we will. Because we're going to get to that perfect and complete lack of nothing sooner than we thought. In Jesus' name, we're going to get there. But it takes one step at a time by not letting somebody offend you or not letting something offend you. That's the only way to break free from it. It's the hardest. But don't give it any power. Just take it away. Take that power away from that person, place, or thing and say, no, I'm not going to do that. I could have easily done that several times this week, but this week I didn't do that. And this week I know several in here that shared with me they didn't do that. And because they didn't do that, they got abundant blessings this week. We all did. And we're getting to see that. And when you start seeing stuff like that, it starts having the breakthrough. That becomes your new normal. And guess what? You're not only making that your new normal, you're making your children's new normal and their children. Because the key is we want to break those generational curses one by one. And we'll take 10 by 10 too. But you definitely are here to set a generational freedom. And that's what we focused on today. That's what we stand for. That's why we stand in that gap to say, yes, you might be in a situation where someone else raised you. Yes, you might be in a situation where you lost a loved one or your child. Yes, you might be in a situation where you dealt with addicts or anything like that, but it all was part of your endurance. It was all part of your plan. Every part of it is going to give somebody else hope. When they see you, they see your pretty face on the stand, they're going to be like, dang, they went through all that, And they're still beautiful and standing. Amen. And I can do it too. More than you know, I've seen like Alice Cooper this week doing a testimony about, and you know how much more people's going to follow him to Christ than a pastor? Mm-hmm. Millions. And thank God that he was saved and set free. And that's just one example. And the pastor was sitting, they were having an interview together, and he's like, he says, son, you don't understand how many millions you're going to bring more than I did, because they get to see the change. They get to see it's a relationship. It's not a religion at all. Amen. It's a relationship. And when you got that, you got everything.
Amen.
And that's what you work for. You are meant to be that too. In your circle, you touch more people than you think. And you react and interact with more people than you think. In Matthew 11:28, I think we just get too hard on ourselves sometimes when we mess up, or because we messed up so much. And Jesus don't care about that. When you watch this new show I've been watching, it helps you to really put to pieces the Bible and how the disciples actually just were human beings just like us that messed up and failed, and God chose them first. Jesus chose them first to walk with him as each an example of every person we are today.
Okay, Matthew what?
Matthew 11:28. It says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It don't say you have to clean up yourself before you go to him, right? Oh. And you could read all around that. He don't care about none of that other stuff. He forgives you the second you start speaking to him. And he forgets it. He's not like us. He forgives it and forgets it. He said, hey, that's not you no more. Go back to the one we just read. He says, the old is gone and the new is here. And you are meant now to be a living, breathing example of love and hope and joy and so much more. He wants us to know that, yes, people might push us away because of it. Yes, people might reject us from it. And people might look at us crazy at first from it. But let somebody in their family get sick. They know who to come to. They know who to talk to. They come into you. So that you can be there with them, because they see how strong your faith is. They see how strong your light is. So keep doing it. When you think that you're not doing something, you're doing a lot. And I know a lot of people in here are struggling, and online are struggling with being a Christian. And they got people in their household or in their family that they're like, man, they just never going to get it. They never going to try. Trust me. As you speak in life into them. But if you try to fit in with them, and if you try to fall for their crap, you're going to become the crap. Jesus said it right there in Matthew 17. He said, you will become the poop that they're doing. You said it. Y'all go look. Jesus said some stuff. Like Colin said, he was gangster. He said what he had to say, and he didn't play with nobody. And you can say what you got to say, too, if you don't say it judgmental. That's where people get it crossed up. Jesus said it, he meant it, and it was the end of it.
That's right.
It wasn't this picking on you, pointing you out. When you get to read Matthew from the first verse to the last, you get to really know who Jesus is. And you get to know how you're supposed to act and react. And he is a very loving, funny, direct, strong guy that you got to look up to. And you just fall in love with him more and more and more with every time you sitting there looking at it like, oh my goodness, he really just said this.
Yes,
he called them fools and hypocrites.
Oh, yeah.
And he just really, really put them in their place. So it's very important that you understand there's a difference between doing it as a cynical person, or a difference as doing it as loving like he did. Don't try to fit into it. Try to be strong in it. In Matthew 10:22. And I might be a little off. He's funny. I might be a little off with the chapter. So you can read the whole book of Matthew. And find that this he says it. He says it. When we were sitting in Bible study reading that, we was just all looking at each other like, oh my goodness, he really called us poop.
Yes.
In Matthew 10:22, it says, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but he who endures to the end will be saved. So that means whoever endures it to the end is going to be saved. And he means it because he don't change. He's not like us. He don't change. Nothing changed him. He was beaten. He was mocked. He was ridiculed. He was betrayed. He was anything you possibly could think of, he was done to. And we can get through it too. We can't use it as a crutch. And we can't use it as an excuse because he's standing there right in your face saying, hey, I know. I did it too. That way I couldn't sit there and just say it and not know it. He said, I did it and I showed it and I know how you feel. And he says, but we can get through it because I went through it for you. And just hang on to me. In Leviticus 25:17, I told y'all we had a lot of verses, but we need all this stuff in our gumbo pot. Because we need to be healed and set free from every angle. Especially before these holidays come and people start mingling with family they don't normally mingle with. And they start going on vacations with people they don't normally associate with. It's fine to be a Christian in church, right?
Okay, where are we going?
Leviticus, Old Testament, Leviticus 25:17. It's easy to be a Christian around Christian people. But it's not so easy when you're around family or friends or in a public setting that you might feel like I've got to act a different way to fit in with them. And it's not. You were meant to be placed in that area for a difference. Leviticus 25:17. Got it?
That's
brand new.
That's
port. Yeah.
I mean, my page is not even wrinkled.
In that port?
Yes.
Therefore, you shall not oppress one another, but you shall fear your God, for I am the Lord your God. A lot of the reason why things are going on in this world right now is because people don't fear God the way they feared him then, because... Why? What do you think is the main reason they don't fear God? It's a sad, sad excuse why.
And they've got too confident that nothing's going to happen to them. And
right.
They don't believe that God's coming, that he is.
And a lot of preachers and teachers and churches try to fill people in there by just talking about how much Jesus loves them, right?
Mm-hmm.
But they leave out the part that how he loves them. When you love your kids, you correct them so they don't make a fool of themselves, right? But nobody talks about the wrath of God. Whenever I started saying stuff like that online and stuff, I got attacked so bad. I was like, how could you say Jesus would do that? Because it says it in his word. It says in his word he's going to weed out the goats from the sheep. It says he's going to weed us away from the thorns. It says he's going to... He says, forgive and let me have the wrath of God on you. And so you see people that has bad things happening to them, yourself included. And you, the first thing we should say is, did I do something or am I going to the next level? That should be your two questions. Like we learned in Bible study last week. In the sermon. What can I do for you? And what's in your storehouse already? Same thing. It's like, did I do something? Oh, Lord, forgive me. Or... am I fixing to go to the next level and the devil is trying to get up in my business? Which one is it? It shouldn't question him. Don't never question him. He's got a plan no matter what. All you have to do is ask for forgiveness or forgive somebody and just stand strong in the stuff that you already know how to do. And you're going to get to that next level every single time. You're just going to keep going up and up and up. Like I say, we're going to be the ones that are not sitting in the ground waiting for him.
Amen.
We're going. We're going to learn, in Jesus' name, we're going to learn so much that we do it, and we are going not to sit in that ground waiting for him. We're going when we die. Right. Or we're going before we die. One of the two, he's going to take us. And we found that out, and now that I know that, that's our plan. I'm planning that. The heck with the new trip.
I used to say, don't say no one to my grandkids. Yeah. Being raised.
And all of them coming with us.
And
yes.
Now I say, I'm ready anytime, you know, I'll know them one day.
Yep, they'll be back with you. That's right. And that's hard to do, but in Jesus' name, we're not going to have to wait like that. Because we are His children and we are His servants in this world that are going to fight for everything we have to get Him fishers, be fishers of men. And get people, and just like He said, I don't want to just see you. He said, don't you let me just see you. He told us that in the last chapter, right?
Right.
He said, don't let me come and just see you standing there. I want the people I trusted you with you, right there on the side of you. So don't forget that part.
Yes.
Romans 1:28-30. Chapter 1, 28 through 30. Chapter 1, verses 28 through 30 in New King James Version. And this is a very powerful chapter to study. And this is where we're going to start mainly talking about the whys. You ever wonder why they have so many people that say, I just don't know why I love that type of person. I don't know why I have those set of cravings. I don't know why I want to kill somebody. Why I want to kill myself. I don't know why I would like men if I'm a man. I don't know why I like women if I'm a woman. I don't know why I overeat and I know better. I don't know why I don't eat enough if I know better. This is going to answer all those questions right here, okay? Because this is, we teach everything, right?
Amen.
We're not going to just beat around the bush and get a full house. We're going to get a full house in heaven.
Amen.
So Romans 1, 28 through 30. It says, and I'm going to wait till y'all there because I want y'all to see what it says yourself.
He said 128 is a Christian.
And if in the words of Jordan, he says, man, he didn't leave out nobody. And he was right. Right?
That's right.
He said he didn't leave out nobody. So remember that when you're reading this. It ain't just a one-liner type of thing. He says that even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to the biased mind. So that's what we're talking about, right? Renewing your mind. So he said God gave them over to the biased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, they are backbiters, they are haters of God, they are violent, they are proud, they are boasters, they are inventors of evil things, and they're disobedient to parents. I don't know about y'all, but I think everybody's in there, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we've done figured out, like Jesus says, we're all in sin, and we all need Him, right?
Yes.
Right, every single day, every single day. So don't judge somebody else. If their sin don't look like your sin, don't judge them. They're caught up in a generational curse, and some of them genuinely feel the way they feel because of a generational curse. But guess what? If you're a Christian in front of them, if you love them like Jesus would love them, you don't love the sin, you love the person, and you trust God to change the sin, just like He's changing it in you, then guess what? They have a chance for generational freedom, and it's because of you. Not acting like an idiot and a foolish jerk or a hypocrite sitting in church all holy and then go in on the street and be like looking at them all funny because they high on the street. Don't do that. Don't do that. God can heal them the same way He healed us from gossiping and any other thing that you do that's in that list. In Matthew 6:33, it's how you do it. Is by seeking Him first and His right standing and everything. That's how you do it. If you sow in love, if you sow in forgiveness, if you sow in grace, if you sow in mercy, if you sow in joy, guess what you're going to get? You're going to reap it. I say that all the time. You can't plant bananas and get pecans, right? Can't do it here either. You've got to sow in the good stuff to get the good stuff. And when you start seeing good things happen around your life and in your life and through your life, that's when you start saying, well, that's like God's little pat on the back, like, hey, you messed up today and somebody showed you mercy. You messed up today and somebody showed you grace. That is like a literal pat on the back because you sowed that in somewhere else and God gave it back to you. So He's the one that's supposed to give it back to you. In Galatians 6:8.
Whoa.
Oh, you want me to read Matthew 6:33? I can. I'll read it with you. Matthew 6:33. It says, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. And that's the New King James Version. And that's what he's trying to say. In everything, seek him first. You need to, having trouble, like I said, fixing your hair. You having trouble because your pants is too tight all of a sudden. Just say, hey, Lord, help me to watch what I'm eating this week so my pants are fit and I don't want to buy a new one. You know, just something. Everything. He says, seek me first in everything. That's the keys to the kingdom. Seeking him first in everything. Somebody's on the side of you at work and they just won't shut up and you're tired. Or somebody on the phone with me just won't shut up. And you're like, Lord, if you can, take that time. If you can't deal with them talking in your ear and they just won't shut up. We got to be real, right? They got people that just talk too much. And so if they talking, just stop what you're doing because you're not listening to them anyway, right? And say, Lord, please give them wisdom and understanding that they can be heard with just a little bit less. Please give me the patience not to get aggravated with them, not to feel the way that I'm feeling right now. That's how you take power and authority. Instead of getting off the phone aggravated, then they feel like they done you something. Guess what? They're going to call you back. Mm-hmm. Because if they feel like you did them something, they're going to call you back. Because they start feeling guilty and their head starts spinning out and they feel like they got to find a reason to call you back. Right? It's not just me, right?
No.
Right.
Okay. All right. So when this happens, you're not listening anyways because you done tuned them out. So just start praying. Say, Lord, calm me down. Help me to be here for this person because obviously they need to talk about something. And please give them wisdom and understanding of what they're saying. And I'm telling you, you're going to start seeing a change evolve. You will. I get through most of my work days like that. And trust me, it gets easier and easier because then you start really hearing them. Whenever they call, you really hear them. You don't get frustrated with them. And you get to give them a little bit of joy and peace that you need or gonna need eventually. Sow in the right thing and you'll have the right thing given back to you. In Galatians 6:8. And that's Galatians 6:8. It says, those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. So that's how you get there. If you're sitting there only looking for yourself, only looking for yourself to be heard, only looking for the things you need, only looking for the things that you got to get by with that day, that's all you're going to get, that stuff. But if you spiritually look to help other people and to gain freedom for other people by your actions and reactions, then you're going to lift yourself up and others in a great harvest in the Spirit. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. It starts to help. You start to see it around you, and then you start to see it around others. Maybe it's a child that don't really serve the Lord all the way. You start seeing them all of a sudden blessed. Because your blessings. Guess what that means? That means you broke that generational curse. The generational freedom has begun. People will say, they like to say, well, they don't deserve to be raped, and they don't deserve to be an addict, and they don't deserve to be beaten by their parents, but just because their great-grandfather did it, right? So they don't deserve to be blessed abundantly with a new house and a new vehicle just because their mama did it, right? Yes, that's God's word. He says, we break it either way, so you have the choice to break it for them. But guess what? That person will understand eventually that it came from that source of God. And because it came from you standing in the gap, either way. They love to say the 10,000 things you didn't do right, right? Yeah. To the million you did right, right? Let them start just seeing the right in you every single time. And you mess up, say, hey, I messed up, I'm sorry. I'm human. I don't think we understand our parents are growing up just like we're growing up. And sometimes we'll hoard our own them because we look to them to protect us and guide us and watch over us, but we don't understand they were dealt a crappy hand too. And we need to show grace and mercy and help them heal too. Sometimes we are the ones that got to help them grow.
Yeah.
In John 10:10, I know I have a lot of verses this time, but he just said, Guess, are you serious? I got a full week ahead. He said, yep, I'm real serious. He said he had a full week too.
Damn right.
Probably dealing with me.
Everybody.
Oh my goodness.
All of us
combined, my goodness. We think we got something to deal with one kid left at the house or two kids left. He's like, I gotta deal with all y'all. What y'all talking about? You don't have time for me. He said, I got time for you with all these other kids. You better have time for me. John 10:10 says, the thief comes only to kill and to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. So always remember, if it's fear in it, if it's worry in it, if it's concern in it, it's not God doing it. It's the devil's doing it. But you're not going to give him authority. You go ignore him, right? And you go say, Lord, even though he's attacking me, I'm going to understand that you let him. You can say that. I understand you let him, and I'm going to pass this test. I am going to pass this test. I'll forgive that person. I'll ask you to forgive me if it's you, something you've done. And we're going to go to the next level each time, every time. We go in there. It's time to get there. In James 1, 13 through 15. And these verses are important because whenever I noticed Jesus taught like that too. He would say something like, Son of David, Son of David, Son of David, Son of Man. And then he'd turn around and say, I'm the Son of God. He was letting everybody know, this was your heritage. This is what to do. I am flesh just like you. I am the Son of the Father. And so are you. So are all of you. Jesus did the same thing. He's letting us know, yes, there's generational curses. Yes, there's generational freedom. Yes, you're not getting there by a work system. You're getting there by me. And I just like everything to be covered so you don't leave ever thinking I'm preaching on one thing. Like, you've done all this bad stuff to yourself. You didn't. Jesus, you know what you do and you know what you don't do. And you have no idea what your great-great-grandfather and mother did, right? So you can't focus on that. And you can't blame them for that because you're doing stuff in your life right now that's giving them, your children and grandchildren, grief, and you're like, man, I love my grandchildren. Sometimes we feel like it's a different kind of love, so I ain't gonna go too far with that. It's a different kind of love, I'll say. So you feel like sometimes you got a lot more patience and love for them than your own child because you don't have to be with them 24/7. Some of us don't. Some of us do. You know, some people do have to raise them, but that's good. God gifted them with that. But you have to understand there's a reason for all of it. So James 1, 13 through 15 says, let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. So don't ever say God's tempting you. Don't ever think that he's going to tempt you to do something bad to prove some kind of point. He doesn't do that. But he knows his child of God. He knows how much you've learned. He knows how strong you are, and he believes in you. So he will let people hurt you so that you can show who you are, because he wants you to actually reach the person that's trying to hurt you. He trusts you like that, but it's not that easy, right?
Amen.
It's not that easy. So just remember that he's not doing it as some sick, twisted game that some people like to say. He is doing it to say, I know my child's not going to let me down. And he also knows deep down inside we're going to let him down a few times, but we're going to get back up, and we're going to ask for forgiveness, and we're going to be healed and set free from it. so our kids and our grandkids don't have to do it, right?
Okay.
In Romans 15:13. It says, now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. So you will abound by hope and peace and joy by the Holy Spirit. Your flesh will never accomplish that on your own. But in the Spirit, you will accomplish it every single time because the Holy Spirit's living inside of you just like he did with Jesus. Same thing. He has more power and authority than us, but he says, I've given you the same power and authority that lifted Jesus from the grave. So he's given us the same thing.
Powerful.
Right. That's very powerful. It's just like a bunch of little Jesuses walking around. I don't like saying that too much because then somebody will think I'm saying that we're in the place of him. I'm not saying that. He gave us the same power and authority, the same options, the same chance to bring people to Christ, to bring people to God. Can't do it without him at all. But you have that same power and authority in you when you ask to be saved. And that's just how powerful you are. In Isaiah 58:11, and I know it's a lot of verses, so if you start writing them down, I won't feel bad. But I love that y'all want to see them yourself. That way you know that you're being taught right. And like I said, I know we go through a whole chapter usually on one set theme, but he had a different plan this week. So take the time, even if it's 1 week a month, one day a week or something, and study those chapters that we're going over today.
Isaiah what?
58:11. Isaiah 58:11. This is for the ones that get to read or get to hear the word of God, especially, it's for everyone. And you're like, man, this is going to be too hard. I'm just going to run. Right?
Yeah.
This is too hard. I'm just going to run. I can't do all that. I can't say all that. I can't stand up for myself like that. I just can't do it. I'm in a different circle than you. I don't have the same advantages of you. I just can't do it. Trust me. I'm in those same situations every day. And I know everybody here is too. We're in the same situation every day. He don't want you doing it as a forced thing. And he don't want you doing it. He gives us each our own talents, he says. All he might do in one of you today is say, hey, today, instead of this, do that. It's just one word. Instead of this, do that. And that's it. That might be all he expects from you for a year. Because he knows what it's going to take to undo all the stuff that we do. Right? 40 years of stuff he put inside of, like 38. I did to myself. It's going to take more than these seven or eight years that I got really, really intimate with him to undo all that. Right?
Amen.
It can happen in day one. It's what your talent is. It's what your gift is. It's what your eagerness is. Because I was a Christian since I was probably 14, 15 years old. But I was just the one that carried the label, I guess, because I thought that was the right thing because that's what I was taught. Hey, you pray when you need something. You go to church when you're supposed to. And that's about it, right? That's what churches teach sometimes because you don't receive the same things when you go. Or you go to other churches where it's just a routine thing. And then you learn when you get intimate with the Lord that it's an everyday thing. If you wake up and say, good morning, Lord, you are in for something great all day.
Amen.
If you just wake up and say simply, good morning, Lord, acknowledge his presence. You go to bed at night and say, I love you, Lord. Thank you for getting me through another day. Good night. He would cherish that prayer more than you sitting there saying 5,000 things where you just trying to get through. He would. Just say, hey, Lord, I love you. Good night. Thank you for everything you've done for me. Sometimes that's all you need at first. Because if you get overwhelmed, you're going to run. You're going to run every single time. I know it. Because it happens over and over again. I don't tell y'all nothing I ain't been through. I'm telling you. Just sit there and say, I love you. In the middle of the day. I love you, Lord. Thank you for this. Just constantly acknowledge his presence. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul in the drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. That's powerful. That is so powerful, knowing that you're just a water garden, that he's just going to keep overflowing his word on you. In Matthew 17:20, I'll wait if y'all want to go to it too. I'm going to actually Matthew 17:20 and Hebrews 11:1 if y'all want to come and put your finger in those two places.
Hebrews 11:1
and Matthew 17:20. I just, Jesus and my husband also, he said, if you're going to do this, show it in the word. Don't just stand up there and speak it. Show it in the word. He says, show it. I want to see it. Because, you get misled as a Christian sometimes in your life and you get distracted. You got to see it to believe it sometimes. In the word, not Jesus. Jesus is ever present. I know y'all feel him. In Matthew 17:20. It says, so Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief, for assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. That is a very, very powerful message. It helps you to know you don't have to have this tremendous faith. He's just saying, if you go to me, even if I'm not going to call no name, even if a certain person just betrays you every 5 minutes, you're sitting there like, why do you hate me so much? Why are you always doing this to me? Why are you calling me so much? Why are you always talking about me? Why are you sitting there praying for me, but you talking about me? Why are you sitting there acting like I bother you? And you act like you care for me. Why are you acting like I bother you now? It's those little moments, those sins that you say, help me with the sins I don't know about. That's them. When you sit in there teaching somebody the word of God and then you act like they're bothering you when they try to talk to you. Those are those little unknown sins that we don't know about. You have to have the patience to listen. And you have to have the patience to endure it. And Hebrews 11:1 says, by faith, we understand, is the little title in that section. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So faith is just that. It's just activating God's way instead of your way. That's all it is. And by doing that, you're going to have a lot of powerful movements change in your life. You're going to start to see that have that childlike faith, just that innocence, and other people will feed off of it. We're going to go to Isaiah 29:16. It says, surely you have things turned around. And I want to say this. I don't preach this much and I don't talk about go to all these sections. So y'all don't not watch online every Sunday because we got to do what God says to do. I know it's a lot of verses and I know I stay in one spot to get Jesus's point across. But today he really genuinely said we fixing to have a big movement happen. And he wants us to have all the little ingredients to embrace it. So that we can't say, well, I shouldn't have did that and live in regret. He wants us to know, hey, get back up and we're going to get through this. He says, surely you have things turned around. And he has an exclamation mark there. He says, shall the potter be esteemed as the clay? For shall the thing made say of him who made it, he did not make me, Or shall the thing formed say to him, say of him who formed me, formed it, he has no understanding? So in the NIV version, it basically says, can the clay say to the potter, form me this way? No. That's what the NIV version says. And this is a little harder to understand the way he's wording it, but it still means the same thing. He's saying, can the clay say to the potter, I want to be like this? Move everybody out my way. Move that crazy boss out my way. Move that crazy child. Make the child be okay and not sick anymore. Make the child obey me every 5 seconds. And do it like this, Lord. I know better than you. We can't say that. We got to endure it and grow from it, because our parents put up with our crap and their parents put up with their crap, and it's going to keep going on and on, right? Until we completely, perfectly break the curse. And when we do, it brings change. So we can't tell God, hey, you should have did this, or why are you doing this to me, or anything like that. Just understand it don't happen like that. It don't work like that. We can't tell him how we want things to be done. We can ask him, and he'll help us. He'll either help us through it, or he'll move it, because he says he will. But don't suggest your way. Because he's gonna take you the whole other route, so you don't suggest your way again. You'll go all the way around the circle and get back there, and he's gonna say, okay, you're gonna ask me that mess again? Exodus 34:7. He will definitely take you all the way around. I said that before. I said, when me and my husband was teenagers, I wanted to go to school in the law field, and he actually went to college. Back then, he went to college to be a truck driver. I don't know if he still do or not. We was doing that, and then all of a sudden, we was fixing to be, he finished, and I was fixing to be finished, and we took a whole nother route in the world, right? We took a whole nother route in the world. Well, come along 40 years later, not 40 years later, I ain't 60. That was what, 30 and 20, we'll say 20, God forgive me. 20 years later, we'll come back and guess what we are. If we'd have stayed on the path that he told us in our teens, we would not have went through all that crap in between. But maybe y'all wouldn't listen to me the same way, because if I had a perfect life all this time, y'all be like, well, she don't know what I'm going through. She don't know what I've been through. She don't know what it's like to be in jail. She don't know what it's like to deal with addicts. She don't know what it's like to have a struggle in income. Yes, I do. I know how all of that feels. And whenever I speak to you, I'm speaking from my examples. Most pastors like to stand up and speak about the stuff they heard about the congregation. I use myself. I got plenty of footage I can use to help you to understand that if you stay strong and you stay focused, he's going to get you through it every single time.
Okay, where are we going?
We're going to Exodus 34:7.
I know I've been gone off the path. I'm going somewhere.
I know. I'm trying to keep talking so the people online don't be waiting on me fit. I'm joking. I'm saying, sometimes she just stands there 5 minutes. And I'm like, yes, because I have patience. You don't. And in Jesus' name, you're going to have patience too.
I would have just said, you better write it down.
I will not. I won't do that. I'd rather you see it with your own eyes. Exodus 34:7 says, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving inequity and transgressions and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the inequity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation. So you need to see that, right? Because that's where it's at. He tells you, yes, you might go through bad stuff because of your great-great-grandparents, but guess what? Your great-great-great-grandchildren can go through great stuff if you get your crap together and you do what's supposed to be done. And that's what's important, to know that we can change it today. No matter how much stuff we did, he don't care about none of that stuff. He said, just start it today, and that's over with. It's done with. We're breaking it not only for you, for all of them too. In Deuteronomy 30:19, I think I'm doing it on purpose. I think he's doing it on purpose to you this time of day. Man, we do not do this every Sunday. Come back. Miss Faith can justify me. Right?
Deuteronomy 30:19.
So one teaches you that, and this one teaches you the opposite. That way you know that it's true. Deuteronomy 30:19. Yes, it is.
Well, you got it,
Boobie? Thank God we should have fun in church. Say, this day I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live. That is powerful. Amen. You have that strength. You have that power. Keep those verses handy. When somebody says, God won't do that, either way it goes, yes, he will. This was before Jesus came. This is, when you want to get to know God intimately, read the Old Testament. You want to get to know Jesus intimately, read the New Testament. They're woven into both. But that's how I like to teach. If people say, well, Old Testament's history. No, it's history. It's your heritage. It's your treasure. Right. It's all of it.
It's your roadmap.
It's your examples. But it's how you get to know God. That's how you get to know him. And that's important. So you don't make any excuses. Ecclesiastes 3:1. And I think this is the final verse. The rest I'm going to read it because it's something that I wrote down that I didn't want to just talk on. And that's Ecclesiastes 3:1. And I don't know about y'all, I'm going to read that, but if y'all, when I read this part, it probably is kind of like that verse that covers everybody in it. It covers something about everybody in it. So sometimes I like to tell you, just close your eyes and picture Jesus speaking to you, because that's, he told me, read this, don't just talk about it. So it apparently is for every single one of us. Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, everything has its time, is the little title. It says, to everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. So this is what I have that I was writing for. It says, we always have the choice to go through this life with God or without God. We cannot expect all to be sunshine and rainbows just because we are taught this either. Understanding no one owes us anything. We did not earn anything alone. We did not have to be rewarded or compensated for all that goes right or wrong. Some children are lifted up for the whole world to see, then pushed out into the world blinded. That the parents do not understand why they cannot get it right, or why we have to try to buy our way to the top, or why we have no respect, morals, or integrity, because we are taught this. Parents put us on the pedestal, then all of a sudden we can never be satisfied. Therefore, we start to fill those spots with material things or men and women. The reason for the Potter story is to help you better understand there are stages in this that you can get to and go through to become the child of God you were meant to be. Some of us done a lot of damage to get to the stage we are in right now. So it takes God a little longer as he helps us to peel back the layers in his timing, because he knows how much we can tolerate without leaving. God knows what it took to get your attention on him. God also knows what will push you to run and what will intrigue you to stay. His timing is not like our timing. He knows some he has to work on much slower than others to make it stick. He knows some of us have to go through rough times to stay with him because we're that stubborn. He knows some of us have to be alone and cast out, away from everybody else, to know that He is with us and not distracted by others. God knows. He is an all-knowing God. He is a gentleman that it will not rush you or force you. He wants you more than you ever will know. So do not be concerned if you are not doing what other Christians are doing. Do not be concerned if you're not feeling what other Christians are feeling. We each have our own talents. We each have our own gifts. We each have our own timing, and we each have our own journey. Just because someone seems to have it all together does not mean that they do. And just because someone does not seem like they have it all together does not mean that they don't. God and only God searches the heart and knows. It takes time to get to the center. Picture an onion that you built layers and layers of life on. It takes Him time to peel those layers off to get back to the center. With each circumstance, we pile on another layer for protection. Well, when God comes into our lives, He peels off each layer and becomes our protection. To get to the center, to get to the new you, you have to be focused on His love. It was just a cover-up for others because of the life that happened. So I hope that helps you to understand that it's not always going to be sunshine and rainbows because you're a Christian, but you're going to get to that one day because He says you're going to be perfect and complete, lacking nothing, right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we're going to come over here, Chelsea, with the camera. And just to give you a little example of what He does, I don't think I need this. He takes like that Play-Doh. I'm going to show y'all an example of it. Just so that it sticks into your brain. Because I know I've got to see stuff. And I know Jesus knows we've got to see stuff. Because He used parables throughout the whole Bible, right? Through the whole Bible. I should have cut this open before. I might need some scissors, Chelsea. When your children come, you get distracted. Mm-hmm. So I didn't have all my stuff prepared. So I wanted a rolling pin to show you that whenever you are becoming a Christian, you feel like that. You being rolled by a rolling pin or smashed down by everybody around you, right? Mm-hmm. But then when Jesus does come in, He starts to put the pressure on you. So you feel all that pressure from the whole world and everything else and from Him. You feel all this pressure to be perfect and everything else. And then when He finally gets you to be perfect and complete, not lacking nothing, you got to take all this junk off, like old jobs and old people and old addictions and old friends and all this stuff, right? Because you can't have all that stuff distracting you from life. And then you become that perfect creation in Him. But you can't get there without cutting all that other crap off.
Where'd you get that one?
You cannot. In this little Play-Doh pack. Oh.
I said, she just pulled that all apart and made perfect part.
No, I had it right here. This is like Jesus, and this is going to be us. Yes. So realize that it doesn't just, that person that you walk in church and you're like, man, they got it all together. I'll never be like that. Trust me. They're going through stuff too. They just have faith and they're showing that God can and will overcome their journey. And He's not going to leave you or forsake you for anything. So we're going to listen to this worship. And for the first song, if y'all want, just bow your heads and don't really even get up. Just bow your heads and just let God speak to you. And then we'll praise it out in a second, okay?
There is no copyright to this music.
Yeah.
There is no copyright to this music.
Okay. And the winner of the, what you call it? The picture outside for the carnival is Mallory Desitel, if you're watching, and we'll post it later as well. And that's Mallory Desitel.
Praise God.
Huh?
Hallelujah.
A Bible and...
I know for sure all of my days are Y'all didn't see your hands up, guess what? All my people left a long time ago, but Welcome to Pastor Jill and to the author. Let God work through y'all.
What?
God is gracious, God is good, let us thank Him for our food, for our heads, we are fed, thank you, God, for daily bread, amen.